Welcome to Life Study of the Bible, brought to you by Living Stream Ministry, featuring the ministry of Watchman Nee and Witness Lee, two ministers of God's economy who served together in China for nearly 20 years. Watchman Nee was imprisoned by the Chinese government in 1952 and remained there until his death in 1972. Following his imprisonment, Witness Lee carried on this ministry in Taiwan and eventually in America and ultimately around the world. He served the Lord for more than 70 years before going to be with Him in 1997. His major contribution was through a 21-year labor he called Life Study, an exhaustive commentary on the entire Bible. This program is based on those messages. Before we join today's show, we'd like to give you our website where you can find more programs just like this one. It's lsmradio.org. Again, lsmradio.org. Now, here's our show today. In the last chapter of Revelation, the Apostle John reports the Lord's final words to him and to us. Chapter 22, verse 6 says, "And he said to me, these words are faithful and true. The Lord, the God of the spirits of the prophets, has sent his angel to show to his slaves the things which must quickly take place. And behold, I come quickly. Blessed is he who keeps the words of the prophecy of this scroll." Twice more in this chapter, the Lord repeats the warning that he is coming quickly. Like John, we all need to be those who heed these words and this warning. And here to help us do just that today is Francis Ball. Francis, thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much for allowing me in on the last message, I believe, next to the last.
It's the last actual message of the Life Study. It's the conclusion today, Francis. Tomorrow we will have one more program in Revelation, really kind of a review program. This word, this chapter, is the conclusion of the book of Revelation, and it concludes not just the book of Revelation, but it concludes the whole divine revelation of the Bible, Francis.
Amen.
And in it we see a series of warnings, followed by a marvelous declaration, a joint declaration of the Spirit and the Bride. And finally it ends with a call for all of the thirsty to come to the water of life. Quite a tremendous way to conclude the Bible, isn't it?
It is marvelous, isn't it?
Francis, let's get right to Witness Lee today, and then you and I will return for the first time that we have to fellowship on these wonderful points.
Very good.
First of all, in this conclusion, the Lord gives us a warning, warning us with his soon coming. He says, "Behold, I come quickly." We have to listen to the word. Don't think that he has been tottering over 19 centuries. He is somewhat slow in his coming back. We shouldn't think this way. Look at the world situation. You couldn't know what will happen within few days. Especially today in this age, everything could happen so quickly. Anyhow, we must all the time watchful and praying. And we must also get ourselves prepared. Prepared in the spirit and prepared in our daily life. Lord has to cover us that we may be the watchful, praying, and prepared people. Then the Lord, in this conclusion, tells us that if we keep the word of this prophecy, we will be blessed. You see, it says clearly, blessed are those who keep the word of the prophecy of this book. This book is put out mainly for the blessing of God upon his people. But whether we will participate in the blessing or not, it all depends upon how we deal with the word in this book. You have to take this word. This book warns us not to seal this book. This should be all the time remaining open to us and to others. But sorry to say, as you know, this book has been closed, shut up, nearly for all the centuries in the past. True, Martin Luther, the whole Bible was unlocked, yes, yet this book is not so open. But today, we cannot say that this book is still not open to us. We all have to admit, my, what an opening. But don't seal this book to yourself. And don't seal this book to others. You have to keep the book open to you and to others. And this means what? This means you have to dive into all the points of this prophecy. You have to dive into the flow. And you have to live in the word of this book. This means if you do this, you will keep this book open to yourself and open to your family, open to your relatives, open to your neighbors, open to all the people around you. You do need to keep this book open.
Francis, this is very interesting. There's a warning here to those who don't keep the book open, and there's a promised blessing to those who do. Let's talk about what it means to not seal up this book and then the nature of this blessing.
Well, the not sealing up this book is because this is the book of Revelation. And this is called the Revelation of Jesus Christ. Of course, when Daniel wrote his prophecy many, many years before this, he was told to seal up the things in that book because the time was not that near.
Right.
But now, by the time we get to Revelation, particularly to the end of Revelation, we realize that this book is not sealed anymore. That means it's open to us. As Brother Lee brought out, this book is open to us today because the Lord's light has been shining and this word is spoken for the churches. The word is available and open to us today. So we shouldn't let that be sealed up. We should really receive the blessing that comes with this. This also reminds me of chapter 1, verse 3, where the Lord said, "Blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of the prophecy and keep what is written therein." So much depends on our not only hearing it, reading it, but keeping it. So it's quite important now that this book is open to his people, and we should keep it open and receive the blessing that's promised for all who will do so.
Actually, I think we've probably both had experiences of talking with believers, with Christians who love the Lord and love the Bible and yet freely admit they don't read this book. They're afraid of it, and it's too mysterious or this or that. But really, the exhortation, the warning here is very strong. We should not do that. And now in the Lord's mercy, in these days, this book is no longer closed, no longer shrouded in mystery, is it?
That's right. And to see that the signs are the important thing in this book has really opened it up to us.
Of course, we hear from our listeners. We know many of you are faithful to listen every day. Many others are able to catch it just from time to time. So at the end of the program, as we always do, we'll tell you how you can get all of these messages in total. This is the opening of the book of Revelation and something that we are warned and exhorted and encouraged not to seal up. Francis, we want to go on to the next warning in chapter 22. It begins with a word that is frequently quoted. I just want to read verse 13. It says, "I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end." A frequently quoted verse. Actually, it's the beginning of the second warning in this last chapter of the last book. Let's go back to Witness Lee.
There is another warning. Warning with the Lord's reward. The Lord says, "I am the Alpha and the Omega. I am the first and the last. I am the beginning and the end." My, this is not just a warning, but also a kind of declaration. We all have to realize the very Lord whom we serve is the Alpha and the Omega. He is the first letter and the last letter, as well as all the letters in between. That means what? He's everything, and he's able, he's qualified, he's all together so capable to accomplish what he has mentioned in this book. We shouldn't take any excuse to say, oh, this is too high, I can't make it, the vision is good, but it's rather too high, I just cannot climb up to it. Don't say this. Whatever the Lord says, His word backs it. Whatever the Lord says, He is the Alpha and Omega and all letters to back His word. We must exercise our whole being to believe in His word. Whatever He says, don't look at yourself. Don't consider yourself. You are nothing. We all are nothing. If we look at ourselves, I tell you, nothing we could do. But we have to listen to Him and turn our eyes to Him and sight our eyes upon Him, believing in His word. Whatever He says, regardless how high, we say amen. You know, whenever you say amen to His word, you'll be strengthened. You will have the living faith. Faith is not within you. Faith is within Him. If you look away from all the other things unto Him, you will enjoy Him as your Alpha and as your Omega. You will enjoy Him as your everything. Surely He will accomplish whatever He says in this book. We do need to exercise such a faith in Him.
Francis, we both say amen.
Amen.
You know, I love this word. He said something near the end here. It's like, faith is not in us. Faith is in Him. Reminds me of a word of Watchman Nee's that I read in a book years ago about faith and the problems we run into when we try to find it in ourselves instead of finding it in Him. What a marvelous, encouraging word for us to hear at the end of the vision we've received during these past 13 weeks of this life study of Revelation. We mentioned before, Francis, people like to quote this verse, I am the Alpha and the Omega. But there's more to this verse than just a kind of slogan for Christians to latch onto. Let's talk about the spiritual implication of such a description, such a declaration.
Mm-hmm. This is quite marvelous that the Lord would say to His people, I am Alpha and Omega. That's the first, that's the last, that's the beginning, that's the ending. And using these words, Alpha and Omega, we realize that's the first letter in the Greek alphabet,
right,
and the last letter in the Greek alphabet.
Mm-hmm.
And all the letters in between are included. So that means that He is everything that God has to say. There's nothing left for Him to say that's not said in Christ. And what He says, He's fully able to do. So He's the beginning. He's the Alpha. And He's the first. He's the very origin of everything. And He's the last. He's the consummation. He's the ending. So all these terms that are used with this term Alpha and Omega show us that He is fully able to do everything that He has opened up to us in this, and we shouldn't, as Brother Lee said, we shouldn't excuse ourselves saying this is too high. We're not looking at ourselves. We're not able to fulfill this, but there is an Alpha and Omega in us who is able to fulfill all that He has opened up to us, that we could be the recipients of all the blessings of this book.
Francis, we have to constantly keep in mind that this is His word. So whatever He says, our first and automatic response must be,
amen.
Amen. Thank you. Let's go back to Witness Lee. In our final section, we want to see that this declaration, I am the Alpha and the Omega, is followed by another wonderful declaration, a declaration spoke together by the Spirit and the Bride in verse 17. It says, the Spirit and the Bride say, come. Let him who hears say, come. Let him who is thirsty, come. Let him who wills take the water of life freely.
Up to chapter 22, verse 17, up to now. The Spirit and the Bride, they too have become one. The Spirit and the Bride say, come. Don't forget, in chapters 2 and 3, in all those seven epistles, it always says, the Spirit speaks to the churches. There, at the beginning of this book, the Spirit is the speaker. right? And the churches are the receiver of the speaking of the Spirit. But here, at the conclusion of this book, the Spirit and the bride and the Spirit, they all become one. Now, hallelujah, the church is no more just the receiver of the divine oracle, but also the church becomes one with the divine speaker. The Spirit and the church say together as one subject. This one subject is composed of the Spirit and the church. The Spirit and the bride say, come. First come means the coming back of the Lord Jesus. Then let him who hears also say, come. The Spirit and the bride say, come. Let him who hears this declaration of the Spirit and of the bride also say, come. Then let him who is thirsty also come. The third come is not the coming of the Lord. The third come is the coming of the repenting sinners. One verse covers three aspects. First aspect is that the Spirit and the bride say, responding to the Lord, come. And the second aspect is that someone may hear the declaration of the Spirit and of the bride. And this one also have to say, Lord Jesus, come. Then the third aspect is that let him who is thirsty, a sinner, an unsaved one, also come. Not only the Lord Jesus will come, a sinner has also to come. He who wills, let him take the water of life freely. This verse implies strongly, if we do have a desire of the Lord's coming back, surely we will be very much concerned for people's salvation. Do you desire that the Lord Jesus comes? If you do, this desire will stir up a concern within you. You will be so much concerned for others' salvation. While you are saying, come, Lord Jesus, right away, when I tell you a concern would be stirred up within you. How about your cousins? How about your parents? How about your neighbors? How about the relatives? How about schoolmates? Our experience, again, tells us what this verse means. This verse means that if we desire to see the Lord coming, right away, we will have a concern for others' salvation.
Francis, how wonderful is this? I've read this verse many times, but I don't think I've seen it quite this way.
I'm afraid that's my case, too.
Three invitations to come, covering three different categories of people. If we're really those that have it in our heart to declare as his bride, come Lord Jesus, then there must be a concern, a care in our heart for so many others that don't know him yet. As his bride, we really become consumed with what's on his heart, don't we?
Yes, that is really so, and that's such a marvelous closing. Not only the book of Revelation, but the whole Bible closed with such a warm, you might say warning in one sense, but the response of the Spirit and the bride is to come, Lord Jesus. When that's repeated these three times, just to review, the first time, the first occurrence of this word is really referring to the coming back of the Lord Jesus. And then there's the Spirit and the bride responding to the Lord's promise that he's coming. They say, come, Lord Jesus. And the Spirit and the bride by this time are really one. They are just one voice. They are one person. They are one entity. And they are saying together, come. And all who hear that say, come. We hear this word from the Spirit and the Bride because we're experiencing the oneness with the Spirit. There's this desire in our heart for the Lord Jesus to come back. Those who hear this word also say, come. There's that yearning for the Lord to come. But this puts something else into us, Chris, and that is a desire for the ones who have not tasted Him yet, not had a drink of this living water. So they are thirsty. And now the invitation is turned from telling the Lord to come to tell all the sinners to repent and come. Come, that they may drink of the water of life freely.
Francis, this is, I think we're both struck, this is a marvelous, godly conclusion to a marvelous and mysterious book and wraps up the divine revelation in total, ending with this dual cry to come from the Spirit and the Bride and from the hearers to the Lord and then in all of our hearts and from the Lord Himself to the sinners yet who has, as you said, those who have not tasted and have not drunk of the living water to come as well. The entire life study of Revelation has been one unveiling after another, and it ends in a very fitting way. We mentioned before we have a little review tomorrow, a program that I don't think you want to miss. It's tremendous in the way it ties so many aspects together. But I just want to take a moment at the end and point out some of the resources that we have talked about through these last 3 months related to this book and the things that are available for you as we were encouraged today to not seal up the words of this prophecy, but to get in them, to dive into them, as he said. We have a wonderful opportunity for you all to do that. We've talked about, of course, the Life Study Messages. It's a 4-volume set, the Life Study of Revelation. We also have a chart that we made available midway through the broadcast of this Life Study, a chart that's at the end of the recovery version of the New Testament that covers the 70 weeks of Daniel, which is an integral part of this revelation, plus the coming of the Lord Jesus and the rapture of the saints. We still have these charts available for you as well. They are packed with references and a way for you really to put this whole picture together in a marvelous fashion. And then we have the resource that we've mentioned the past week or two when we have touched this matter of the New Jerusalem and really the matter of heaven as it is commonly understood, and that is the latest issue of Affirmation and Critique, a quarterly journal that is published by Living Stream Ministry. This special issue, which comes out just as we are in the life study of Revelation. We don't believe this is an accident. This is, we believe, divine arrangement, though we didn't set out to do that. It has worked out that way. 144-page special edition, all devoted to the common understanding of heaven versus the divine revelation of the New Jerusalem. Many articles, we've talked about it, so we do want to mention that to you as well. Finally, there are several books in the inventory of Living Stream Ministry by Brothers Watchman Nee and Witness Lee that touch many of the points that we have touched in this life study of Revelation. All of these resources, what we believe the Lord has committed into our hands is not for us, but for all of His hungry seekers, and that's what we're trying to do in this broadcast each day, is make these things available to all of you. So please, our toll-free number, write it down if you have a chance. If you can't call us now, call us whenever you're able. It's 1-888-LIFE-STUDY. That's 888-543-3788. Our mailing address is Living Stream Ministry, Post Office Box 2121, Anaheim, California, 92814. Or you can send email to us, radio@lsm.org. As I mentioned, tomorrow, our final program on this live study of Revelation. Please try to be with us then. I'm Chris Wilde. You've been listening to Life Study of the Bible with Witness Lee. For 21 years, Witness Lee conducted a comprehensive life study, unveiling how the Bible presents Christ coming to be life to man. These audio programs are based on those messages. But to get the full riches of the life study, we hope you'll visit our website, lifestudy.com. From there, you can read over 1,800 life study messages in their entirety, or download more audio programs like this one, all free of charge. Again, the website is lifestudy.com. Thanks for listening today.